friend Dr. Charles Apoki. This is Word and Wisdom Time. I want to share some issues with you concerning the recent developments in Nigeria, particularly the End-SARS demonstrations. And for some of you, you might not know that apart from being a medical doctor, I have a master's degree in public administration. And I did that at the age of 56, and I made the best result in the graduating class. I made 10 A's, 7 B's, and 1 C. Now, there are things I observed, and I have tried to conceptualize them into concrete terms. I want to tell you about the iron law of oligarchy and the Apoki's theory of two tribes. The iron law of the oligarchy states that when organizations, fellowships, movements want to start, they start with an ideal. Help us to build a nation where no man is oppressed. Though tribe and tongue may differ, in brotherhood we stand. Those are lines from the first national anthem of this great country. But you see, when organizations, movements form, and they now consolidate, and they now establish whatever, a time comes when an oligarchy, an elite class, a group of people, corner the privileges to themselves and leave the others to wallow in poverty, lack, or be oppressed. And they guard this oligarchy with an iron fist in such a way that it's very difficult to break into them. So, taking my bearing from the iron law of oligarchy, I want to talk about the two-tribe theory that I have concerning underdeveloping countries. Before now, we had developed, we have middle-income nations, and we have developing nations. But there are, I'm using a terminology, underdeveloping nations. Nations that are falling below their levels of development years back, and falling, going downwards, down the drain. And Nigeria falls into that category. Nigeria has become an underdeveloping nation. If you read the book by Lee Kuan Yew, the president of, the leader of one time of Malaysia, the way he described Nigeria in his book is very shameful. If you hear some of the things Ghana says about Nigeria, when they discovered oil, they said that they would not be like Nigeria. And so, when I went to medical school, the College of Medicine was one of the best hospitals in the Commonwealth. I had students from Hong Kong, I had students from the United States of America come and do postings with us in medical school. When I was at Government College Ugeli, I had lecturers from India, from Europe, and from different nations. The UCH, the University College Hospital Ibadan, the King of Saudi Arabia, used to come there for treatment, send his families there for treatment in the early 70s and into the early 80s. And you see, Nigerian doctors were taken to Saudi Arabia to practice medicine then. But you see, we have gone downwards. One of the things that brings this under development is the two-tribe theory of Dr. Apoki. When we fight for independence, when nations fight for independence, number one, I'm older than Nigeria. I was born before 1960. So when people fight for independence or fight for liberation, they fight as a force, as a body, with unity. But with time, the Africans and those in underdeveloping nations, a new set of colonialists, internal colonialists, come into power. So in Nigeria, you don't have north, you don't have south. We have so many tribes, but there are only two tribes. The tribe of the oppressor and the tribe of the oppressed. When you hear people say presidency should rotate to their region or stay in their region, they are not saying it because of the masses. The northern part of Nigeria has held power for so many years and several times. Go to where the present president comes from, Daura, you will still see dusty roads. You will still see mud houses. You will still see insecurity. Somebody very close to him was kidnapped recently. So you will see poor health services. You will see poor electricity supply. You will see bad roads. Go to where Babangida comes from, apart from Mina and the hill where he builds his house. Just go to the periphery. You will still see poverty. The flood that took place recently, if you see the northern states, where one of the, you see them, they are still poor. Go to wherever, go to where Senate President, Deputy Senate President, Oshiba and Joe and all of them, they come from. You will see poverty outside the main town. So you only have the oppressed, you have the oppressor. You have the rich, you have the poor. You have the opportunists who harness every opportunity that comes. Let me tell you, your president generally in your local community corners most of the resources that come to that community to himself and his clique of leadership. Even if you make a youth president, he will corner employment opportunities to himself and his cronies. That's the way the world is. The opportunities, the opportunists that harness the opportunities, and those who are ignorant and are docile and even want to play according to the rules. The elite, the oppressors, the tribe of oppressors don't play according to the rules. So you have those who carry ballot boxes, who rig elections, who sell their votes for those who will eventually oppress them. The tragedy in Nigeria is that there is a political Stockholm syndrome. Stockholm syndrome is when a kidnapper kidnaps you. After some time, you start falling in love with the kidnapper, particularly women. Stockholm syndrome. That's why a boyfriend that is being maltreated by a girl, if the father goes there to arrest the boy for beating his daughter, the daughter will go and bail the boy. It's Stockholm syndrome. In Nigeria, we love our oppressors. Let me just quickly go further with these two tribe nations. These policemen shooting at young people protesting. I saw one of them was demonstrating with his gun. The idiot cannot go to Sambisa, was demonstrating with his gun as if he was he has watched too much of Rambo films. That idiot, when he retires, he's going to go into the tribe of poverty. Coming here now, I passed a soldier who has retired. If you see him, he's a shadow of life. I know a mobile policeman who must have shot like this idiot shooting. He died without collecting his benefits. Meanwhile, the commander of SAS, former retired commander of SAS, was saying that why would a 20-year-old boy, 30-year-old boy, be driving a 7 million naira car? Ask that wicked man, what is the price of the car he drives? Ask him, do people not have right to drive cars? I bought a car as a youth copper. Ask him, what was the price of the bike the son of the president was riding when he fell down? You see, there are only two tribes. There are only two religions. Not Muslim, not Christian. Two religions. Those who exploit us and those who are exploited. Let me even talk about the Fulani herdsmen. You will see Meiti Allah sit in air-conditioned offices. We have big calves. They will say, if you touch a Fulani, are there children in the forest with cows taking care of cows? They can buy AK-47, buy guns, use a helicopter to drop things for Fulani herdsmen in the bush, while their children are in the UK, their children are in the US, their children are air-conditioned offices. How many of their children are in the bush? There is no Fulani. It is either you are the cattle rearer, the idiot that stays in the forest to kill women and rape them, or you are in the class of the oppressors that own the cattle, and you sell 8,000 cows every day in Lagos. If a cow is 100,000, that's 80 million a day. There are only two geographical expressions in this country. There is no north, there is no south. We only have those who are on top and those who are below. When they want to steal our money, there is no north, there is no south, there is no Christian, there is no Muslim. They gang up together to steal. Let me tell you, there are only two tribes in this nation. Those two tribes, I have enumerated them. But there is a third tribe that does not have an identity. That tribe are those who exist for purposes. Fela Nikulapo Kuti was one of them. Ganifawe Emi was one of them. And there are a few others who belong to no tribe. They are phenomena. They are ideas. Those people, you see them protesting, you see them struggling for the good of humanity. They are nationalists. They are tribeless. They are phenomena. They are ideas. God bless you. I'm your friend, Dr. Charles Apoki. Don't let my wicked generation use you to destroy this next generation. Let me quickly say this about the two-tribe theory. Do you know why university systems don't work in Nigeria? We, the elite, send our children overseas, destroy the school system so that you can be poor, so that we can use you to carry ballot boxes, so that you can do shwan for us. Even in the police force, listen, you policeman, listen very well. The children of the elite enter the police force as graduates. They are going to rule you in future. They are already DSPs. They are already assistant commissioners of police. You from a poor family, shooting your fellow poor human beings. Their children will boss your children. Your child will not be able to join the police because it will require a commissioner to sign his form. Your child will not be able to join the army because it will require a major general to sign his form. You will end up at the bottom of the ladder. They destroy the economy so that there will be no employment, so that we are cheap to manipulate. They make ASU and doctors always go on strike so that you cannot use your brain. The oligarchy, the oppressors, hate reasonable people. They hate people who can talk. They hate people who know their rights. Even in religion, the day after serving as an usher and your shoe hits alignment, go and dare propose to the bishop's daughter. You will discover that there are two tribes in the church, the elite and the poor. Let me quickly say this. The battles of the elite are fought by the poor. The battles of the elite are fought by those from the lower class. When Daddy Freeze, who is an elite, whose mother is from Romania, a European, and a professor of law, and the father is a medical doctor, said insulting things concerning Bishop David Oyedepo. Notice this. David Oyedepo's son did not ever make any comment about Daddy Freeze on Facebook, on social media. He was busy building his future because the elites don't have time to fight the fight. They use those who are not in their class to fight the fight. Let me quickly tell you something. No matter how you rise and go up, they always know where you come from and they will treat you like that. That's why you see their children, they answer two names. Giwa or Sage. They answer two names. Showolu, this one. They want the name of the husband, the name of the wife, of the wife, to join together, to act as a passport, to be introduced to the elite. I tell you something, fight the fight of your life in this generation. Fight to salvage this nation and destroy this two-tribe attitude. That is a sign of underdevelopment. God bless you. I'm your friend, Dr. Charles Apoki. Keep listening to Word and Wisdom channel. Share this post to educate our people. My next post will be on the strategy of the elite to oppress the poor. God bless you.